Survivor is a game full of tactic, social awareness, challenges, alliances, and my next guest was wild enough to endure the intensity of the island not once, but twice. So joining me now is Steven Fishbach from Survivor Token Cheese and Survivor Second Chances. Excited to speak with you once again, Steven. How are things?
I'm great. I'm delighted to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Yes, I'm excited you're here as well. I'm always appreciative of your insight that you provide me. So I've got a lot of questions about kind of what's going on with this season, as well as kind of some things that are swirling around on social media this season as pertaining to Survivor. So first things first, I've seen a lot of opinions on social media regarding the show sticking to solely three tribes when starting the season, kind of specifically in the new era. So do you feel like Survivor should switch it up to two tribes or perhaps show more variation of groups of players prior to the merge?
I love that question. I think you're absolutely right. So I think one of the big complaints about this three tribe season, especially with the new era, is that we've seen in a lot of these seasons, one tribe absolutely collapse. And especially with this the brutal kind of conditions of the new era of Survivor, where, you know, they're taking flints from the tribe. They're not giving them any kind of, you know, luxuries or comforts. As soon as this losing streak happens, it just kind of spirals out. And then the strategy becomes somewhat reduced on these really small tribes that just sort of whittle, you know, sort of implode. And I would love to see some two tribe seasons. You know, I think years ago, the format of just two tribes had started to get a little bit stale, where, you know, a decade ago, really, we saw these two tribe seasons. There were two tribes of 10 people, and then one group of five or six people on one of the tribes would stick together and they would just vote off the other tribe, you know, or the other members one by one, and it became a little bit repetitive. I think the game has evolved now where two tribes can be really fun because people don't vote like that anymore. They don't stick together in these giant alliances of six people anymore. And I think that to see some variation in the way the game is played would add a lot of freshness and kind of give a little more strategic depth to the new era.
Yeah, I could not agree more. I would love to see just more switch up, like I said. So another thing that's kind of been sparking a lot of people's interest, maybe even sparked a little bit of controversy, if we want to call it that. So Jeff openly said before the beginning of this current season that he's no longer interested in casting villains on Survivor. But personally, as a viewer and reviewer of this show, I feel like villains are kind of like an integral aspect to the game and often what has made the show memorable, a kind of like standout character. So do you think that was a wrong call to make or maybe to vocalize on Jeff's part?
I actually think that what he said, and to be, it got a little bit sort of misconstrued, or okay, maybe even it sort of like exploded into its own thing that was really, in my opinion, beyond what he meant. And I certainly could be wrong. You know, I don't want to be a soothsayer trying to, you know, read the tea leaves of Jeff's statements to extract their true meaning. But I thought that, you know, what he was saying was he didn't want to cast like basically villainous people to play Survivor rather than, you know, letting a strategist kind of emerge in a villainous way. Now, I do think there is maybe too much of an emphasis on, you know, finding the good. One thing I love about Survivor is that it does kind of find the goodness in everybody, but there should be some jerks. You know, we should let there be some jerks. We should like see them at their jerkiest, you know, allow people to kind of be. Just like Survivor can often find the best parts of yourself, you know, being in this intense environment, playing this super difficult game under brutal conditions, you know, sometimes the best part of you emerges. Sometimes that suffering and that challenge lets people be, you know, noble and gracious and thoughtful and generous while they're playing this very difficult strategic game. It also lets the worst parts of us come out. You know, people can be duplicitous and mean and backhanded. And I do wish we had more of that, almost from a story perspective. That said, I do think kind of what Jeff's point was, you know, he doesn't want to cast like jerks and like mean-spirited people on the show. But I still think maybe just from a storytelling perspective, we could lean into some of those worst impulses to, like, to your point of like bringing out the villainous, mm-hmm, instead of like everyone's story being an inspirational story, because it gets a little repetitive.
Yeah, I think that's a very good way to say it, and I definitely think it could have been taken out of context. But I also think it's important what you said there at the end, because we're definitely seeing in the new era that they're like focusing heavy. It's like very overly edited on these like very inspiring, kind of overly emotional stories. So that's an interesting thing to kind of think about too. Now, focusing on the current season, Banu was the most recently voted out player. And viewers have a lot to say about him, both his gameplay, personality, beyond other things. So kind of as a former Survivor player, what are your thoughts on his time on the island?
I just want to get it out of the way that Banu's story is amazing. Yeah. Right? Banu is someone who basically came from nothing, worked his way up as the first person in his family to go to high school, I think he said. And like, that's incredible. Like what an inspirational story. That said, as a Survivor contestant, I mean, he was infuriating to watch. And I had so much empathy for the other contestants out there who constantly had to deal with them. I mean, with him. You know, there was one scene in this last episode where, you know, he comes back from this conversation with Q, who's just been giving him, you know, a motivational talk, trying to teach him how to play Survivor, you know, trying to like build him up so that he's, you know, a good member of the tribe. He goes back to the shelter and immediately says, like, okay, Kenzie, it's your turn to emotionally coddle me. You know, I mean, just that level of demand placed on these other people who are suffering themselves. They're going through a rough time. And not only that, but he's just blown up all their game. So what happened was he had just been at this journey with members of two other tribes, and he, you know, essentially exploded their game. He said, you know, Q and Tiffany are an unbreakable duo. Kenzie is a mastermind. He goes back and tells Q, Tiffany, and Kenzie that he said this. They're furious at him, but instead they're immediately put in the position of having to sort of coddle him and treat him basically like a child, you know, emotionally, you know, validate him just to kind of keep him with them. It would have driven me crazy. I played once with somebody who was like that, and it was very difficult. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, you're struggling yourself, and to always have to put all this emotional energy into coddling an adult, it's really very frustrating.
Yeah.
But because you're playing Survivor and it's a game for $1 million, and if you don't do that, you could, you know, lose your whole game. You know, you're in this impossible position.
Yeah, yeah. That's definitely, I have to imagine, a challenging balance there. Because like you said, you're there to win $1 million, not to babysit someone. But ultimately, that could play into your demise. So remaining on the Yanu tribe now, like you said, is Tiff, Q, and Kenzie. So assuming that the tribes stay the same up to the merge, there's no swap of any sort, do you think that Yanu stays strong after this, or do you think they will continue to fall short?
I'm hopeful. I mean, it actually seems like a pretty compact, good group.
Yeah.
They communicate well together. They're all really strong players in their own right. I do think this is going to be really a challenging position for them because they're just physically depleted. You know, I mean, one thing that didn't make the show this past in the past couple episodes, but was released as a secret scene, was there was a huge, horrific rainstorm. And it just absolutely, I mean, being, you know, rain on Survivor is just horrendous. It goes on, you know. It's rain, you know, it may, like, but when you're in your normal life, you can go inside or wear an umbrella or, like, you know, dry off. When you're on Survivor, you know, you're freezing. It's impossible to sleep. And, you know, the other tribes have some supplies. They have tarps. They have fire. They have flint. They can get dry. For poor Yanu, they basically have nothing. Now they have a tarp. And just that, you know, they've been on Survivor for almost 2 weeks now. To never have fire, you're just depleted, you're exhausted. You know, they can't get fish, they can't get even like shellfish to boil because they can't, like, you know, they can't boil water. And so I hope there's a swap. I hope there's something that comes that can save them, because just from a pure exhaustion point of view, they can't have very much left in the tank.
Yeah. Yeah, well, and they all seem like three very strong players, so it'd be nice to see them kind of get a fair chance at the game. Something that has really been piquing my interest, especially leading up to knowing I was going to speak with you, is the how medic evacuations kind of play into the game. So a few episodes ago in the season, we see that Raynan was medically evacuated. So how much do you think that a medical evacuation kind of affects other players' games, or just maybe even the overall gameplay?
That's a great question. And I think that's one of the most sort of unseen but challenging parts of a medical evacuation is that it sort of like spirals out to everybody's game and certainly the people on his tribe. So Randon from Nami was pulled because of what they were worried was a neck injury, right? But it turned out to just be a trapped nerve. But so many people are basing their whole games around Randon. You know, Venus, he was her number one ally. You know, obviously he played into Kevin's game and to Soda's game and to Hunter's game and to Liz's game on that tribe, you know, they are making their calculations with the assumption that Randon is going to be able to play it out. Now, of course, something could happen to Randon in the game. You know, he could get blindsided, but that's part of the game, you know, and that's sort of something that if you get kind of upended or surprised or have your plans scuttled by the game itself, that's the game you're signing up to play. Mm-hmm. It's really frustrating, I guess, from as a player's perspective, to see those plans just kind of shattered because of something that's obviously it's part of the experience. You're surviving in a very difficult, challenging environment, but it's not really part of the game itself. And I've been on a season with a medical evacuation, and it's devastating because so, you know, you're calculating not just 3 days out, you're calculating 30 days out when you're thinking, yeah. Well, no longer. Now you're calculating 26 days out. But, you know, all of these decisions you're making are based on a very intricate web, and a medical evacuation cuts all that short.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you said that perfectly. Something that's been super interesting to me this season as well is a player like Hunter. So he is kind of like the ideal survivor player in so many different ways. And I think on this season, he is specifically vital to their specific tribe's strength. However, given if he makes the merge, often once we see those kinds of players hit the merge, they're often targeted quickly. Do you think Hunter should be scared?
He definitely should be scared. And, you know, it's so funny, Blake, you know, we were talking earlier about how everyone has a sob story. And I saw someone on Twitter joking that, you know, Hunter's backstory is that he's perfect at everything and does everything excellently. Yeah. You know, like his whole story is like, I'm amazing at everything I do, you know, whether it's I was going to be a doctor, or now I'm a teacher. I'm amazing at challenges. He's amazing at the wilderness. You know, he made, a bed to sleep on. He made a broom for them to use. Although I'm still not totally sure on why people are sweeping up the outdoors. But yes, I mean, we've certainly seen in the past that someone who's so good at so many things gets gets targeted very early on. We saw it with Caleb, last season. But Hunter is so good that there's a world where not only is he really good, but he's also got a lot of his alliance intact, that he might have a little bit of protection going into the merge. I mean, that's my hope. I mean, we saw it with Jonathan a couple seasons ago, this, you know, literal Goliath of a human who was single-handedly bringing his tribe to victory.
Sure.
He made it very deep into the game. I think he was fifth or sixth place.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can certainly see someone who has all of that ability, you know, lasting longer than you expect it to. I also am kind of hopeful, or I think it's possible, that Hunter is so good that he could almost like go on a crazy immunity run.
Okay.
You know, you can see Hunter being one of those, you know, freaks of the game, freaking, you know, where he just like wins, you know, eight of the final immunities.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and I also think it's interesting because not only is he strong physically, but he's playing a strong social game as well. So I really would like to kind of see him continue to do well. One more player spotlight, Steven. So Jim was very quiet the first few episodes, and then we kind of see her play this idle trick on her tribe, if you will. So do you think that Jim will remain stealthy in her pursuits and prove to be a memorable player, or do you think she's going to get caught eventually?
I think this is a great question. I think I don't love the way she played it because, mm-hmm. you know, we saw that she had, in fact, the show even did a flashback to 4 days previous where we saw her find this Beware advantage, which, you know, has the opportunity to get her an idol. And, you know, she has this thing. Nobody knows about it, right? In fact, we see that the whole tribe is looking for the idol together because they're so not suspicious that anyone has it already.
Yeah.
And then by planting this fake clue, and then, no, you know, we see the tribe digging for hours and hours under this tree looking for what they suddenly start to suspect each other. You know, there's a very good chance that suspicion could fall on her, just as it could fall on anybody. Mm-hmm. And, you know, suddenly you're creating dissension. You're creating this question of where is the idol? When you didn't have to have it, she could completely in secret have this idol, and by kind of raising these suspicions, suddenly she's, you know, getting people to ask the question, which I think is kind of unnecessary. And I do know that when you're on a winning tribe, you kind of get bored. You're like, they haven't been tribal council at all. You know, there's a lot of doubt and finding things new, but often is where a lot of these really dominant tribes fall apart, is because mm-hmm. they get bored, they get restless, they want to make a move, but there's no moves to make. And so I do kind of think this sort of move is an unnecessary sort of flourish from Jim.
Okay, that's very interesting. I appreciate hearing that. Now, my final question, it's still rather early in this season in the grand scheme of things, but who do you feel is maybe playing the best game, or maybe even someone you're predicting to kind of win it all just based off the first few episodes?
Yeah, I mean, it's so hard, especially in this day, in this era, when we've seen so many players basically come out of nowhere. I mean, Gabler in season 43 being the prime example. But, you know, I certainly think, you know, four episodes in, I never would have guessed that Marianne was going to win. You know, D is maybe the person I would have most, or, and certainly not Erica either, four episodes in. So, I mean, of the past five seasons, you know, maybe D was the one who you could most even begin to guess had a good shot. And even she, I did not think was going to win. But you know, I love Maria. I think Onsiga has a really good shot. I think she's in a very good position. Honestly, I'm starting to think Hunter has a chance. You know, when I was talking about the show after the first episode, my co-host of a podcast I run, The Know-It-Alls, Rob Sesternino, Hunter was his winner pick. And I said, no way. Hunter's the guy they're going to get as soon as the merch happens. Yeah, he's gone. But he's in such a good spot, and he's so good. I actually would not be surprised if Hunter was in the mix.
Yeah.
And I also think that someone like Tiffany, you know, as tough of a spot as she's in, I think Tiff could be there at the end. And what a great story she has. I survived this horrific experience at Yanu. You know, I was a target coming into the merge because of all the things Banu said. Now I'm here. I mean, I would vote for her.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, post-premiere up to this point, Tiffany has been my winner pick, so I'm going to keep my fingers crossed for her. I really think she could do well, but I really honestly think that you're spot on with any of those names. I think any of them have a very, very good chance on this season of going far and maybe even winning. Well, Steven, thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for all your insight, especially as a former player, on everything happening today in the world of Survivor. For all of our viewers, brand new episodes of Survivor Wednesdays on CBS, and then, of course, streaming on Paramount+.